worshiping with us, whether, like I said, online or here in person. I have a few announcements for us. A reminder to please check our Facebook page for any upcoming changes pertaining to COVID-19. I know we're all getting tired of that, and yet that is the reality right now. And so we want to make sure we're communicating the best we can. We are now only at one service, and so thank you for everybody who made that happen this week. I also want to introduce our piece of art today. I know it is small, but we're going to put it on Facebook, and I also hope you might come individually, not make a crowd, to come and look at it. But this is done by Owen Robertson, and Owen, if you would stand up or wave your hand so people can see who you are. And she said, oh, I have this piece of artwork that Owen did for me about my story of how God called me to try you. And it has to do with dogs. And so, I hope you'll ask her about it, but Owen, thank you for letting us use your artwork this morning. And last but not least, I want to say thank you to our musicians and our readers and the ushers and the wonderful staff here at Triune that helped to make worship today possible. So let us all turn our hearts and our minds and our souls over to the worship of our living God.
Amen.
Jerry, welcome on up.
I was never good and perfect. It is when families live together in unity.
A family formed by faith, we gather to worship the living Lord.
Long with lifelong followers, seeking substance, new disciples searching for grace.
A family fashioned by faith, we gather to kneel before the giver of mercy.
Children of God, come. The Lord gathered us in and called us his own.
Let us worship God.
Great is thy faithfulness, great.
Faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. God's grace. She knew God's love was not bounded by place. Jesus, you listen, debated then hid. For in her asking, her faith was God, you still bless those who seek you in prayer. You welcome dreamers who faithfully dare. In Christ now risen, your mercy extends. Those on the
reason to know the context of a story, it's today's scripture. And even knowing some of the context doesn't always mean we are left with all the answers to our questions. Today's scripture reading involves two stories, and though they may seem unrelated, they may have more in common than it first seems. However, the second story can often be viewed for some as troubling and uncomfortable, while for others it may seem to be extraordinary and liberating. This story takes place on the margins where the boundaries of geography, ethnicity, race, religion, gender, you name it, are crossed. This story reminds us how messy life can be, amen? And that not everything is tied up neatly with a bow and a three-point sermon. Let's dive in. In Matthew's gospel, Jesus is debating with the Pharisees, a group of powerful Jews who held to the oral traditions, the law, passed down from Moses, as well as the written law. And Jesus also is debating with the scribes, the legal experts, regarding what are faithful and acceptable practices in religious life. Tensions rise as the Pharisees and the scribes throw the disciples under the bus for not having washed their hands before they ate, which breaks the tradition of dietary laws and temple laws. These dietary laws placed a high premium on the purity of the individual. And in today's passage, Jesus is turning expectations on their head. Before we read this morning's scripture, let us first pray to the Holy Spirit for illumination. Let us pray. Holy and merciful God, by the power of your Holy Spirit, open our eyes and our hearts to your word of love, mercy, healing, and blessing. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Listen to a word from God found in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 15, verses 10 through 28. I will be reading from the New Revised Standard Translation. Then he called the crowd to him, that is Jesus, and said to them, "Listen and understand. It is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but it is what comes out of the mouth. what you said?" He answered, "Every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted. Let them alone. They are blind guides of the blind. And if one blind person guides another, both will fall into a pit." But Peter said to him, "Explain this parable to us." Then Jesus said, "Are you also still without understanding? Do you not see that whatever goes into the mouth enters the stomach and goes out into the sewer? But what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and this is what defiles. For out of the heart come evil intentions, murder, adultery, fornication, theft, false witness, slander. These are what defile a person, but to eat with unwashed hands does not defile." Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But he did not answer her at all. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she keeps shouting after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." He answered, "It's not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." And Jesus answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed instantly. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This debate about what or who is clean or unclean in the eyes of God has now led Jesus to call together a crowd. There's obviously a difference of interpretation and opinion between some temple leaders and legal experts and Jesus. Jesus doesn't mince his words. He declares those in the debate blind and unreliable guides who are not sanctioned by God. Amen. Jesus accuses them of majoring on minor matters such as hand washing while ignoring disruptive societal practices such as murder, theft, and slander. God knows what is pure, you see. God knows the intentions of the heart. The scene shifts suddenly as we move into the second story and into a different location. Jesus traveled to the district of Tyre and Sidon, a majorly Gentile area that is foreign territory to Jesus. Keep in mind, Jews and Gentiles didn't really mix. The Israelites saw Gentiles as pagans, as worshiping other gods, as being unclean. We don't know how soon into their arrival there or from where, but a Canaanite woman, a local, came towards them shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." And we are told that Jesus did not answer her at all. Nada. Nothing. Crickets. Then in the midst of the awkward silence, the disciples butted in, urging Jesus to send her away because she is just too loud. Jesus answers her, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." This wasn't the first time Jesus had referenced this in the Gospel of Matthew. But this tenacious woman didn't take no for an answer. And she came and knelt before Jesus, begging much like Peter did in last week's gospel story. Jesus doesn't help. Instead, he answers her with words that cut no matter how hard we try to soften them. He says, it's not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs. Really, Jesus? A dog? Are there ways around this most disturbing moment? Maybe. We could spend weeks upon weeks delving into the various interpretations provided by many scholars as to why Jesus may have reacted or behaved the way he did. But the truth is, we simply don't know because we aren't told. There is as much ambiguity going on here as there are explanations for Jesus' behavior. Maybe, some say, Jesus was irritated with the disciples' attitudes regarding women and Gentiles. So Jesus decides to use this occasion as a test to help her and to challenge the deeply rooted prejudices within the hearts of the disciples. Or, another says, maybe Jesus is simply deciding to describe the reality of his mission. The healing he offers is for the children of Israel first. Or maybe, another one chimes in, Jesus is just tired and wants a break from the relentless demands of his ministry. And or maybe is blinded by his own prejudices. After all, we sometimes forget that Jesus is both fully human and fully God. But regardless of why Jesus did what he did, I want to explore the role of the Canaanite woman in this story. While Jesus' response bears attention, what is often bypassed is the acknowledgement of the woman's great faith. Amen? This faithful woman did a really hard thing. She refused to keep silent any longer. She was relentless in her attempts to ask for mercy from Jesus. Here in Matthew's account, this unnamed woman is not only a Gentile, but she is a Canaanite. Canaanites were traditional enemies from generations ago of the Israelites. And yet, at the beginning of Matthew's gospel, in the genealogy of Jesus, the family tree, the writer of the gospel goes out of his way to mention two female Canaanite ancestors of Jesus, Tamar and Rahab, as well as other Gentile women in Jesus' family, like Ruth. It's as if the gospel writer is foreshadowing throughout the entire gospel, and particularly in today's story, the conversion of the Gentiles into the kingdom of God. Although we aren't told exactly when, Jesus' mission eventually opened wider to include the Gentiles into the faith. We know this because at the end of the Gospel of Matthew, in the Great Commission, the risen Christ commissions his disciples to go and make disciples of all nations. All nations, amen? This Canaanite woman seems to have had some prior knowledge of Jesus and his ministry. He has a reputation, it seems. And she is also a desperate mother on a mission for mercy for her daughter. And in her resilience, she crosses all sorts of boundaries. Her daughter needs help, and she isn't afraid to make a scene. She approaches and addresses Jesus and at least 12 of his male disciples in public, which was a huge taboo. Women weren't to address men in the privacy of their homes, let alone in public.
She is the very personification of what the Pharisees, scribes, and probably even the disciples would call unclean. Despite the hurdles she faces, this woman persists, this unnamed woman persists boldly. She stays in the ring, so to speak, with Jesus, addressing him four times. Even in the midst of rejection, she asks him to have mercy on her, calling him Lord and Son of David, a messianic title. For a Gentile woman, friends, to use these two combination of titles in addressing Jesus, an itinerant Jewish teacher and preacher, is quite unexpected. Well, after Jesus calls her a dog, the woman, unwilling to be dismissed even by God, is aware of her location and the limitations that are being placed on her. She does not succumb to them, but brings them into the light and calls them into question. Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table. Notice the word master in reference to table. She doesn't seem to need a seat at the table. As for her, the crumbs on the floor will be sufficient. She doesn't object to God's having mercy on God's chosen people. It's as if she trusts that even the crumbs that fall on the floor from Christ's table will be enough. She doesn't seem to believe that there are limits to God's mercy. In that one sentence, she embodies and emboldens faith lived out. Faith lived out in love. Hers is a brilliant response, not least because it cuts to the very heart of Jesus' boundary-breaking, taboo-busting, division-destroying ministry of table fellowship. After all, he's the Messiah who eats with tax collectors and prostitutes, amen? He's the rabbi who breaks bread with sinners. His disciples are the one who earned the Pharisees' contempt for eating with unwashed hands. No wonder Jesus commends her great faith. Bested by this witty, truth-speaking woman, and bested he is, everyone agrees on that. Jesus kindly responds, "Let it be done for you as you wish." And by his words alone, we are told that her daughter was healed instantly. Jesus has already demonstrated in previous stories in Matthew that he is willing to embrace those whom society rejects. And this encounter with this Canaanite woman, an outsider in every sense, is another reminder and marker of the great story of God's redemptive plan for the world. This woman's story is not simply about one woman's struggle to be heard. It is a struggle of all people to be seen and heard and fully experience God's redemptive love. You see, purity and faithfulness are shown ultimately by those of us who live out Christ's call to radical hospitality and love. Mr. Rogers once said, and I quote, "We live in a world in which we need to share responsibility. It's easy to say, it's not my child, not my community, not my world, not my problem. Then there are those who see the need and respond. I consider those people my heroes," end quote. Friends, we must take a deep look at ourselves and prayerfully ask if we are willing to be faithful and persistent like the Canaanite woman, advocating for those in need and for those who may not have a voice. in our society. That kind of relentless faith work is exactly what we need right now. In this season of racial reckoning and pandemic devastation, will we, as Christ's disciples, be a voice from the margins? A voice that says there are no second-class citizens in the kingdom of God because all are God's children. A voice that denounces violence, hatred, and idolatry. A voice that decries discrimination and mass incarceration. A voice that rejects all supremacy and power wielded against the poor and the oppressed. Friend, God calls us to be agents, disciples of peace, justice, and reconciliation in our world, despite any of the barriers that divide us. And because God calls us and equips us, and God's mercies are from everlasting to everlasting, and they are new every morning, we can do hard things. Amen? So may God grant us the great faith and courage of the Canaanite woman, so that we might persist, we will persist in advocating for the vulnerable and the hurting, no matter how long it takes for Christ to make the world well. Thanks be to God. Amen. As you are in your homes or you leave this house of worship, know that God goes with you. Know that you have been given great faith. So persist. Persist.
Amen.
Persist. Trust in me that God is giving you everything you need to advocate for those in need. And now may the love of God, the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the friendship and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you, world without end. Amen. You'll please wait for the ushers to lead you out of the sanctuary.
Lord.